Welcome back to Chemistry Matters. You're probably noticing that it takes quite a bit of planning to conduct an investigation, but it's important because scientists always want to be accurate. By now, you should have a solid handle on what your independent variable, your dependent variable, and your constant factors are. So let's get back to the classroom to check in with our students to see how they're doing.
Okay, in addition to the distance between where the samples were retrieved, did you come up with three more constants for your experiment?
Yes, we decided that the size of the samples is a constant. Each one is 2 liters, and we're testing 50 milliliters of each sample, so that's another constant. We also decided to place the 50 milliliter samples into white plastic cups. That's another factor that's the same in this experiment.
Great work. Remember, a constant is a factor that's deliberately kept the same by the experimenter. Any factor that can be changed in an experiment is a variable, and too many variables can ruin an experiment. Who can tell me what that means? Too many variables can ruin the experiment. Sam.
Well, if too many things are changing, you might not know exactly why you got the results that you did.
Exactly. In a good experiment, only 2 variables are allowed to change. The scientist changes 1 variable, the manipulated variable. Because it's changed by the scientist and doesn't depend on any other factors, it's also called the independent variable. The responding variable changes as a result of the experiment. It depends on the manipulated variable and is therefore called the dependent variable. Any other variables that might cause the responding variable to change must be kept controlled or kept constant. And for this reason, these are called constant or controlled variables.
Now that you've got a well-designed plan, you're ready to carry out your investigation. Students in a suitable and safe classroom should follow the research plan with river water samples provided by their teacher. Students will test the pH level of the samples. Of course, we always follow standard safety procedures in the lab. Now, for this experiment, we'll need to make sure we're all wearing appropriate safety goggles to protect our eyes. This includes instructors and any lab visitors. If the goggles feel uncomfortable or won't stay in place, let your instructor know so you can see clearly during the lab. People with longer hair should pull their hair back to keep it out of their face. And we can protect our clothing by wearing a lab apron that keeps acids and bases away from contact with our clothes. Just in case, make sure an eye wash station and a safety shower are nearby. That way, if acid spills onto you, you can wash it off of your eyes and off of your skin quickly. And now that we're ready, let's get back to the classroom.
Put on your goggles and we're ready to begin our investigation. We have the 10 water samples collected from the areas 1 kilometer apart in the Ogeechee River. Samples 1 and 2 are from areas upriver from the fish kill. These water samples are from areas with no recorded fish kills. Samples 3 through 8 are from areas of the river where fish and other animals have been found dead. And samples 9 and 10 are from areas downstream from the fish kill area. Use your graduated cylinder to measure 50 milliliters of water from your first sample. Pour water carefully until the meniscus on top of the water sample matches the 50 milliliter mark in the graduated cylinder. Then pour the sample into the labeled container. Carefully wash the graduated cylinder with distilled water between measuring the volume of each sample. Then add 50 milliliters of each water sample into the correct cup. When you finish this part of the procedure, you'll have 10 different river water samples and 10 different containers. Now you're ready to use the pH probe or pH indicator to test for the presence of acids. Team 1, please turn on your pH probe and rinse the tip with distilled water. And dip the tip in water sample 1 until you see the pH of the solution appear on screen. Then record the pH level in your lab book. Team 2, please use the pH indicator and add 5 drops to each water sample. Record any observed color changes. Notice that team one is recording pH numbers. Since they'll have numerical data, their measurements are called quantitative. Team two is recording descriptions of color changes, not numbers. When we describe results without using numbers, we call that qualitative data. Both types of data are very helpful in science. The numbers we use on the pH scale are pretty easy to understand, and we'll get more details on those numbers later. For now, just recognize that the pH scale is a set of numbers that range from 0 to 14. The midpoint on the pH scale, 7, is the number that represents equal amounts of acid and base in a solution. A pH of 7 is usually referred to as neutral. If the pH value is lower than 7, we call that an acid. The closer to 0 the pH number is, the stronger the acid. If the pH value is greater than 7, we call that a base. The closer to 14 the pH number is, the stronger the base, or alkali. Both strong acids and strong bases can be damaging to living tissue. Now test and record the results for all 10 samples. Once you've recorded results for all 10, make sure to carefully wash your containers and graduated cylinder, and then clean your lab station.
We'll take a break once again to let you conduct this experiment. Take your time to make sure you get the most accurate results possible. When you're done, you can remove your safety goggles and move on to the next video on the playlist.